Come and worship, all you who love and serve the Lord, outsiders and insiders, old-timers and newcomers, the young, old, and the in-between. Come as you are, for this is God's house, a house of prayer for all people, and God welcomes each one who comes. Good morning, and welcome home. My name is Tom O'Brien, and I am blessed to serve Memorial Congregational Church as pastor and teacher. This morning and every day, we invite all on a journey of acceptance, connection, meaning, and purpose. Welcome to everyone joining us here in the sanctuary and to those watching online. Know that no matter who you are, no matter where you are physically, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Let's join our voices together in song now. Singing from the Chalice Hymnal, hymn number 342. We'll sing verse 1 in Spanish and in English, and then we will sing verse 3 and 4 in English. I invite you to rise as you're comfortable doing so.
Thank you. My name is Rick Hilpertz. Please join me in prayer. Dear Lord, please be with us on this rainy spring Sunday and throughout the coming weeks as we continue the transition to spring and shortly summer. Please show us the way to better understand our neighbors and those who do not share our views on so many different subjects. Help us to see their point of view with understanding. Help us to seek out the good in each of us and to forgive ourselves and each other for our many mistakes, just as you always forgive us. Show us the way to be better Christians and faithfully reflect your teachings. We ask all this in your name. Amen. Each Sunday we renew our promises to one another and to God. If these words are unfamiliar to you, please feel free to listen. Please join me in the covenant of Memorial Congregational Church. In the love of truth and in the spirit of Jesus, we unite the worship of God and the service of humanity. And as the Lord's free people, we agree to walk together in all God's ways, made known or to be made known to us.
God's way is the way of peace. It's a peace that we are called to take into ourselves and to spread throughout the world. It seems like a daunting task, but it begins simply enough by offering a sign of peace to those around you. Here at MCC, we have a tradition we call the Holy Spirit Handshake. Hold your hand out to your neighbor as they hold theirs out to yours. Leave space for the Spirit. Bring that energy and that love into your heart. I invite you now to share a sign of God's peace with those around you. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Luke's Gospel. We are using the inclusive version of the Bible. It's also written in your bulletin if you'd like to follow along. Listen now for these words from God. After this, Jesus appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead in pairs to every town and place he intended to visit. He said to them, "The harvest is rich, but the workers are few. Therefore, ask the overseer to send workers to the harvest. Be on your way, and remember, I am sending you as lambs in the midst of wolves. Don't carry a walking stick or knapsack, wear no sandals, and greet no one along the way. And whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace be upon this house.' If the people live peaceably there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will come back to you. Stay in that house, eating and drinking what they give you, for the laborer is worth a wage. Don't keep moving from house to house. And whatever city you enter, after they welcome you, eat what they set before you, and heal those who are sick in that town. Say to them, 'The reign of God has drawn near to you.'" Here ends our reading. May we be blessed with wisdom and courage for interpretation. There are a few things that we do in church that sometimes can seem weird. We have all these rituals and traditions. Some have been done for hundreds, even thousands of years. Others may be unique to our congregation. And sometimes worship planners struggle to decide where to put a certain liturgical moment in the service. I've heard some clergy joke that the first question we'll ask God when we get to heaven is, where's the right place to put announcements? Of course, more important than where we put these rituals is the question of why we do them at all. One of these moments is the passing of the peace. It can be right at the beginning of the service as a way to greet each other, or it could be closer to the end, as a way to wish each other well on our journey as we leave church. We choose to pass the peace right after our covenant. For one reason, I think it reminds us that we're on this journey together. So we welcome each other and we recommit ourselves to walking this path with each other. It also gives us an opportunity to reflect on what we mean when we say all God's ways, known or to be made known to us. As I just said, God's way is the way of peace. It's a peace that we're called to bring into ourselves and to spread throughout the world. It seems like an overwhelming task, but it begins simply enough by sharing God's peace with those near us. MCC's vision statement says that our vision is a world fulfilling Jesus' inclusive ministry of peace, love, and justice. Now, when we developed that statement, we intentionally aimed for what's sometimes called a big, hairy, audacious goal. We weren't coming up with something simple or something that can be achieved in the short term, but something that we as a church could strive for, something that sets the direction of the path on which we're headed. It's a big, hairy, audacious goal, and it's probably not possible anytime soon, but that doesn't mean that it's impossible. See, I believe that we can change the world. God knows that this world needs some changing. I believe that we can reflect God's way of peace and shine that around the globe. I believe that we can do our part to create a world fulfilling Jesus' inclusive ministry of peace, love, and justice. Now, it's not easy. It's probably not something that we will see in our lifetime, but it can be done. We talk about practicing our faith. We come to church and we do these rituals as a way to do that, to practice. So we pass this peace in a safe space with folks that we mostly already know, and that's a way to practice what it would be like to share our peace with people outside of these walls, with strangers, maybe even with folks that we want to label as enemies. In about 2 weeks, 8 teens and 5 adults will head out on a mission trip to Cuba. You probably remember that the trip was initially planned for Puerto Rico, but was changed due to a dengue fever outbreak on the island. Experience Mission, the organization that Pastor Marcus and Miss Rachel have been working with, has other options for destinations. Jamaica, Costa Rica, Belize, not to mention exotic places like the Texas-Mexico border. When Puerto Rico no longer seemed like an option, Experience Mission strongly suggested that we choose Cuba. We had to take some time to reflect on that. The 3 staff leaders discussed it among ourselves, and then we took a bit of time to reflect on our own. The parents were then informed and given some time to reflect. And then as a group, staff, parents, and teens, we discussed it, and then we took a little bit more time to reflect on our own. As I've shared our plans with others outside the church, including my extended family, there have been some who are shocked. Why would you go to Cuba? They say. Now, personally, I've had some mixed emotions. Overall, I'm really excited to be going. It sounds like a lovely place, but what draws me even more is curiosity. I'm intrigued. Somehow I feel like I've heard so much about Cuba, and at the same time, I feel like I know almost nothing about Cuba. Simple geographic proximity has meant that Cuba and the United States have had close interactions since Europeans began arriving to colonize the region. Yet in recent history, certainly within my lifetime, the two nations have had strained relationships, which may be putting it mildly. My image of Cuba has been, well, it hasn't really been much of anything, I guess. There's always been this sort of vague fear in the back of my mind. It's always been painted as an enemy in our backyard. And I've heard about Cubans risking their lives to escape the island and its government, but I never really knew why. In recent years, I found myself very curious about what Cuba is really like. So I'm intrigued and excited to go and learn more. The gospel reading that I just shared talks about Jesus sending out his disciples. Now, this is one of those stories that appears in most gospels, although it's told a little bit differently each time. Some versions have Jesus sending out 12 disciples. Luke's gospel has him sending out 70 or 72. Each version has Jesus giving instructions to the ones that he's sending. And again, some of these instructions have some variations, but for the most part, Jesus says, go to new places, accept their hospitality, and offer what you can offer. And if you're not welcomed, shake the dust from your feet and move on. Jesus sends them out to make a difference in the world. They are to go and create new relationships and serve the communities where they find themselves. He sends them out to demonstrate what the kingdom of God looks like, what our vision statement calls a world fulfilling Jesus' inclusive ministry of peace, love, and justice. He doesn't say go and convert people to Christianity and get them to go to church. He says go and heal them and go and receive what they have to offer. On our trip, we're going to have the privilege of serving. We've been told that even though our schedules may change, we may be working alongside community members on a farm that produces help to those who need it. We'll take part in a kids' club working with local children, doing crafts and playing sports. And we'll be offering practical help to families that have children with physical and mental disabilities. But perhaps the most important part of our time in Cuba will be creating relationships. We'll get to know Cubans as humans and as children of God. And they'll get to know us the same way. Now, when Jesus sent his disciples, he also warned them, it's not going to be easy. I think it's important for us to remember, too, that it's not always going to be easy. We'll be in a new place. We'll meet new people. We'll experience language and cultural barriers. And it's probably going to be really hot. But we are going to do holy work. Not converting others to our faith or getting them to believe what we believe. We'll be doing the holy work of creating relationships, one at a time. God's way of peace will be known to us, and we will play a part in spreading a divine love and a holy peace just a little bit further in our world. I'm so grateful to Rachel and Marcus for all of the work that they have done to arrange this trip. I'm grateful for your prayers as we engage this mission. And I am so grateful to be able to go on this journey with this wonderful group of teens, because they're the ones who are leading us. They're the ones who are helping us to create the world that our Creator intends for all people, an inclusive world of peace, love, and justice. So I pray that we may be blessed as we walk together in all of God's ways, made known or to be made known to us in this room or outside of these walls, and especially on our trip to Cuba. Thank you for your prayers. Amen.
Now is an opportunity for us to share our joys and concerns with one another. So let's be in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to be together in community. Thank you, Lord, for this, Rick called it, this beautiful rainy spring day, Lord. Lord, we thank you for those who are here. We thank you for those who had the heart to come but was unable to, Lord. Lord, as we lift up our prayers and concerns and our joys, we ask that the Holy Spirit would be present as we lift up to those who are near and dear to our heart. Most gracious Father, we thank you for all of the prayers, the joys, and concerns that have been lifted up. We thank you for those that were audible and then those that we continue to hold very deeply in our heart, Lord. A special prayer for Izzy. Lord, we know that our pets are so dear to our hearts, and so we ask that you would be with Izzy, Lord. And now, as you have taught us to say the Lord's Prayer, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I have a few opportunities for service coming up this week. As you've heard, we have our Pride celebration in town today at 2 o'clock, from 2 to 4 at Curtis Middle School. It's rain or shine. If it's raining out, we'll be inside the building. If not, we'll be outside. But I hope that you'll come. It's gonna be a wonderful event. We have lots of different organizations showing up. We have music throughout the program. And fun games and lots of crafts and everything. So I hope you'll be there. Next Saturday, June 15th from 10 to 1, the Properties Ministry will be holding another wonderful opportunity for you to come and experience some community and to move your body and to, what other fun things can I add in there? And to make the building look a little bit better. There are some lots of little projects that we always have going on, and our property ministry does incredible work, and every once in a while it's good if we can chip in and help out too. So that's next Saturday from 10 to 1. We've talked about our small group conversations with the core team that was working with the ADAPT process. We want to give you opportunities to share your thoughts, to reflect on what you've heard, and to help figure out a path forward. So we have, I think we have 6 or 7 more opportunities for that. The next one will be this next Sunday, June 16th, following worship. So please take a look at those, and I hope that you'll join us for one of those conversations. And if RSVPs aren't necessary, but if you think about sending me a note, we'll know to expect you. I know that there are other announcements in your bulletin. I invite you to take a look at those. If you have a financial offering for us this morning, we have offering plates as you leave the sanctuary, or you can point your camera phone at the QR code in your bulletin, or anytime you can go on our website, mccsudbury.org/donate, for lots of different ways to donate. We are so grateful for all of the ways that you support the ministries at MCC. And we lift them up. Oh. Giving thanks, let's all stand up and sing the doxology together, and then I'll pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for all that you have given us. In return, we humbly offer up our gifts. Send the blessing of your Holy Spirit over all that we receive and over us. Help us to use our gifts to go out into your world and to do your work, following in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Please be seated. I haven't planned this part out yet. This is Liz. All right, bye. I invited Liz Garrigan-Byerly to be here with us this morning. Liz's daughter Ruth has been attending youth group with us, even though they belong to another church. But Liz is also a seminary classmate of mine, and currently serves as executive minister to area conference ministry, something like that, and for the conference. the conference loves its long titles. So I invited her to be with us this morning to offer a blessing for our mission trip.
Thank you so much. It's so wonderful to be here with you today. In a minute, I'm going to invite those who are present and going on the trip to come forward, but I want to take a moment just to thank you. Alan, which camera, do I need to look at a camera to make sure online? You're just gonna follow me around because I wanna make sure that I'm including everyone. But I just wanna take a moment to thank you. Personally, as Tom said, my daughter has been attending the youth group this year because our church does not have one. And I wanna thank you for extending such a warm and inclusive welcome, not just to her, but to every young person who finds their way into your midst. And on behalf of the conference, I want to say thank you. On behalf of Reverend Darrell Goodwin, our executive conference minister, Reverend Alex Shea Will, who's your area conference minister, and all of our staff and board, thank you for being such amazing partners with us in ministry. You are partners through your proportional giving, through your presence and participation at events, through your prayers for us. You support Tom in being a General Synod delegate last year and next year. You've supported your own members who serve in the wider church. You support us in allowing us to, entrusting us to be your partners in the journey that you're taking through ADAPT, in discerning what your faithful and vibrant future is, which is frankly what all of us are doing in response to the gospel today. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I want to invite now all of those who are attending the service trip to come forward, just up front. Recognizing that not everyone is here, we're going to bless those present and those who are not here today. I don't know if this is a practice you have in your church of raising your hands forward in a sign of blessing, but I invite you to put your hands forward just like this. And join me as we bless them. Join me in the spirit of prayer. Holy, holy, holy God, we give you thanks for the faithful yes of these individuals and of this church supporting them. Bless them, we pray. Bless them with sustenance in body, mind, and spirit for the journey ahead. Bless them with openness to new ideas and people, new food and ways of being in the world. Bless them with joy and stamina for the work they will do. Bless them with courage to be themselves fully and to be transformed by the experience. Bless them with assurance of your grace and presence when things are uncertain or stressful. And bless, too, we pray, those who stay behind, parents and siblings, pets and friends, this church. Bless them with trust and patience, hope and love. Bless them with openness to how they too may be transformed by this experience. Bless all of us who have made this experience possible, who have donated and organized, encouraged and cheered on. In this moment and in all, O God, may we serve you faithfully and joyfully. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Liz. Now I invite you all to offer a blessing in song as we join our voices together once again, singing hymn number 431, Go My Children with My Blessing. And I invite you to rise as you're comfortable doing so.
Oh,
go from this place refreshed and empowered to do the ministry to which God calls you. Travel lightly, for you carry within you all that you need. Notice God's presence in simple, everyday experiences. Whenever opportunity arises, labor for the good of all. And the blessing and joy of God, our Creator, Healer, and Life Giver, go with you today and always. Amen.
Amen.
We have received God's blessing. Now I invite you to offer a blessing to one another. As you face the center aisle, look to those with whom you have shared this time of worship. As we sing together, God be with you till we meet again, found in your bulletin. Great week.